Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamu alaikum. Welcome to Technogenier. In this lecture, I will discuss about the electrical and mechanical characteristics of the fuel cell. Initially, I will discuss what is fuel cell, what are the different types of fuel cell, what is its mechanical composition, and then I will discuss what are the different types of energy which is produced from the fuel cell, specifically the electricity in energy, and then the heating loss which is produced in the fuel cell. And in the last, I will discuss about the electrical characteristics of the fuel cell. So initially, what is fuel cell? As you know, that a fuel cell is an electrochemical device that converts chemical energy into electrical energy. Its structure is similar to the batteries. It consists of two electrodes. One is positive and the other one is negative. The positive side is known as anode and the negative side is known as cathode, similar to the batteries. And we use hydrogen as a fuel, which is then processed to form electricity, and then it is reacted with the oxygen to form water and heat. So this is the basic composition of the fuel cell. Basically, in a simple conventional combustion engine, the chemical energy is converted into heat, and then heat is converted into mechanical energy, and finally the mechanical energy is converted into electricity. If you see that in the conventional combustion engine, there is energy loss when chemical energy is converted into heat, then there is another energy loss when heat is converted into mechanical energy. Finally, from mechanical to electricity, there is another loss. While in the fuel cell, simple mechanism will be performed, simple chemical energy is converted into electricity. So the only loss which is faced is the conversion of chemical energy into electricity. So comparatively, the conventional combustion engine efficiency is very low compared to the fuel cell. Normally the fuel cell efficiency is 60 to 80%, while the conventional combustion engine efficiency is approximately equal to 15 or 20 or 25%. So this is the animated view of the fuel cell. This is from here the hydrogen goes inside the fuel cell, and there is a special membrane which transfer the only the proton, while the electron move from the wire, and this flow of electron shows the current, and then this hydrogen ion with oxygen and the electron produce water, which is basically the output of the fuel cell. Similarly, in this chemical action, some heating process also occurs, and that heating process is also the loss in the fuel cell. So there are multiple types of fuel cell, like alkaline fuel cell, direct methanol fuel cell, molten carbonate fuel cell, phosphoric acid fuel cell, polymer electrolyte membrane fuel cell, which is also known as proton exchange membrane fuel cell, and then solid oxide fuel cell. These are the few types of the fuel cell. And if you see that the basic difference is basically the electrolyte change and the type change. Like in polymer electrolyte membrane fuel cell, the electrolyte is solid organic polymer, and its operating temperature is approximately 30 to 80 degree. As you see that the PEM fuel cell is normally operate in the room temperature, while other fuel cell like solid oxide fuel cell, its electrolyte is basically solid zirconium oxide, and its operating temperature is 600 to 1000. So in order to operate this fuel cell, we need to initially warm up the fuel cell to 600 to 1000 degrees centigrade, then it will work as a fuel cell. Then we have phosphoric acid. Its operating temperature is 175, and it uses phosphoric acid soaked in a matrix as an electrolyte. And then we have alkaline. Its operating temperature is 90 to 100, and its electrolyte is aqueous solution of potassium hydroxide soaked in matrix. Finally, we have molten carbonate fuel cell, and its electrolyte is a solution of lithium sodium or potassium carbonate soaked in a matrix, and its operating temperature is also 600 to 1000. So now the thermodynamics of the fuel cell. As you know that in the fuel cell, the electricity is produced due to the chemical reaction of hydrogen and oxygen, and this process is basically an exothermic reaction, and exothermic reaction is normally a spontaneous reaction, and hydrogen is eager to react with the oxygen and to combine to form water. While this eagerness produces energy in the form of electricity and in the form of heat. So our concentration is to study the thermodynamics of the of this mechanism. So if you see the reaction at the anode, hydrogen is converted into hydrogen ion and the electron, and at the cathode, the hydrogen ion plus the electron and the oxygen will combine to form H2O. So the overall chemical reaction is this one, simple H2 is combined with O2 to form H2O. So the question arises that how much energy is liberated or converted into electricity, and the remaining energy which is converted in some loss. So the energy which is converted into electricity is the basic useful energy, while the energy which is converted into heat is basically the loss in the fuel cell. So before understanding the loss in the fuel cell, we need to understand there are three different types of energy which are basically loss. One is enthalpy, second one is free energy, and third one is entropy. So let me discuss about the enthalpy, free energy and entropy. So what is enthalpy? Enthalpy is basically the sum of internal energy, which is U, and the product of the volume and the pressure of the product of the gas or the product. So enthalpy would be H is equal to U plus PV. So it includes the kinetic energy of the molecule and an energy associated with the force acting between the molecule. So the internal energy of the internal energy plus the observable energy or microscopic form, such as kinetic or potential energy, is basically the enthalpy of the gas, and its unit is basically kilojoule per mole. So if we consider that, let's suppose we have a temperature of 425 degree and pressure A of 1 atmospheric pressure, that would be a standard temperature and pressure. So at standard temperature and pressure, O2 enthalpy is basically zero if it is in gas form, and because it is stable oxygen form. While if we consider the enthalpy or the atomic oxygen O, basically it is not stable, so its enthalpy is not zero. So it is its value is 247.5 kilojoule per mole. So if we analyze the reaction, in the enthalpies of H2 and O2 is zero, because both H2 and O2 is basically stable kind of thing. So the enthalpy of the formation is simply the enthalpy of the result of H2. And H2 depend on whether it is in liquid state or in gaseous state. So this is the basic chemical reaction. H2 plus half O2, it will produce H2O. While if it is in liquid form, the L indicate that it is in liquid form, then its enthalpy is minus 284. While if we consider H2O is in gaseous form or vapor form, then its enthalpy is minus 241. So enthalpy change due to the state of the material change. So these are the enthalpy factors. If you see, this is H in gas form, the enthalpy is 217 because H is not stable. While if we have H2 gas, then enthalpy is 0 because H2 is a stable component. Similarly, that means oxygen in gas, the enthalpy is 247, while O2 is enthalpy is 0 because O2 is stable. However, in H2O, for the liquid, the enthalpy is minus 285.8, and for the gas, H2O is minus 241. For the solid carbon, it is 0. For the gas, CH4, it is minus 74. Carbon monoxide, it is minus 110.5. Carbon dioxide, it is minus 393. And CH3OH liquid form, it will be minus 380, 238.7. So this is a simple example that the high heating value for the methane. Find the high heating value of the methane CH4 in kilojoule per mole and kilojoule per kg when it is oxidized to carbon dioxide and liquid H2O. So if you see, this is the basic reaction, that CH4 combined with 2O2, both in gaseous form, will produce carbon dioxide and H2O, and H2O is basically liquid. So we can calculate this its enthalpy, like CH4 enthalpy. If you see that this CH4 enthalpy is minus 74, so this enthalpy plus 2 times HO2, so the H2 enthalpy is 0. So this is 0, and then we have carbon dioxide gas enthalpy and H2O enthalpy. So if we want to check the change in H or the change in enthalpy, then we can consider the sum of these two enthalpy minus sum of these enthalpy. So this will indicate the change, and this change is basically 890.2 kilojoule per mole at of enthalpy of CH4. Now, if we consider find the HHV value, then it would be the ratio between the enthalpy change in enthalpy divided by the atomic weight of the substance. And the atomic weight of CH4 is basically the value of C is 12, and for the hydrogen it is 4 × 1.008. That means the overall molecular weight is 16.043. If we divide 890, this value divided by 16.043 into 100, because we convert these grams into kilograms, so the value will be 55,490 kilojoule per kg. So this is the HHV value of the methane. So the second parameter is basically the entropy. Entropy can be described as a measure of the molecular disorder or molecular randomness. So entropy is basically the internal energy, and this is the basic, you will understand based on this value, that when an amount of heat Q is removed from the thermal reserve large enough that its temperature T does not change during the process, the loss of entropy S for the reservoir is, so it is basically the ratio between the heat amount of the heat Q divided by the change divided by the temperature. So change in entropy is Q divided by T. As you know that the Q is basically the amount of heat which is transferred due to the amount of the heat, the randomness or the motion of the molecules change. So this Q divided by the temperature is basically the change in entropy. So this is the reaction. We have enthalpy, internal enthalpy, and then output of the enthalpy. These are the two. One is enthalpy in, and the second one is enthalpy out. While the rejected heat, which is basically loss, is represented by Q. So this is the Q, and this is the amount of the heat which is. So in case of in order to find the mechanical equation of the entropy, then the entropy of the reactant H2 and O2 will disappear, but new entropy will appear in H2O that is formed plus the entropy that appear in the form of heat. So when hydrogen combined with oxygen, it will produce H2O, and the remaining heat would be in the form of Q, and this remaining heat basically is the loss. The third one is basically the free energy, and the free energy is called as Gibbs free energy. So the chemical energy released in the reaction can be thought of as consisted of two parts. Number one is entropy free part, and the second one which is called as free energy, that can be converted directly into electrical or mechanical energy plus the part that is appear in the form of heat, which is Q. So the Gibbs free energy G correspond to the maximum possible entropy free electrical or mechanical output of the chemical reaction. This is the internal free energy minus the reactant free energy. If we take the difference, then it will be the difference will be the delta G. And if we check the ratio between delta G and delta H, delta G is basically the useful energy and delta H is the energy which is lost. So if we calculate the ratio, then it would be the efficiency of the fuel cell. So these are the some parameters which are specifically used in electrical components, which is Q, N, V, N, and then I, V, R, and P. So for the for study of the electrical component, we need to understand what is Q, and the Q is basically the charge on the electron, N is Avogadro number, N, V is the volume, N is the rate of flow of hydrogen, I is the current, V, R is the ideal voltage, and P is the electrical power. So the basic electrical characteristics of the fuel cell is that the fuel cell basically process is basically it convert fuel into usable form and filter the output impurities. The second thing is the energy which is produced in the fuel cell is basically in the form of DC, and this DC quantity or the power is very low. If we want to increase the power of the fuel cell, then we combine multiple fuel cell in the form of stack in order to produce electricity, a huge amount of electricity which is useful. The third major point is that quantity of the reaction of the fuel cell is dependent on the control of the input of the fuel. So we can control the input of the fuel, which is basically the hydrogen input. Then the secondly, we need to control the input of the air. Thirdly, we need a cooling agent which is required to maintain the temperature of the fuel cell. So these three components need to be controlled in order to make the effective use of the fuel cell. So the power and the fourth major point is that fuel cell produce DC current, and in order to use this DC current, we need a power conditioning equipment which convert DC into AC. Now another problem in the fuel cell is the losses in the fuel cell. There are multiple losses in the fuel cell, like activation losses, that losses are the basically caused by the slowness of the chemical reaction taking place on the surface of the electrode, because when it absorbs the hydrogen, then this hydrogen will be reacted to the oxygen in order to form water. But due to the in major fuel cell, we need to warm up the fuel cell in order to enhance or speed up the chemical reaction. So for this this is basically the activation loss which we require to warm up the fuel cell. The second one is ohmic loss. The ohmic loss is basically the due to the conduction loss, and when the current passes through the wire or the electrolyte, it will drop some voltage, and that voltage is basically the conduction loss or the ohmic loss. The third one is fuel crossover loss. When we insert hydrogen from one side, some of the hydrogen will be converted into ionized, and it will converted into in the form of electrical energy, while the remaining hydrogen will become out. That the amount which is the amount of the hydrogen which is not used and without and coming out is basically the crossover loss. So this loss is also create problems, because we manage the fuel cell according to the input of the hydrogen, but if that hydrogen cannot be converted into electron, then it would be a loss. The fourth loss is mass transport or the concentration loss. These losses occur when the hydrogen and oxygen gas have difficulty to reach the electrode. Less reactant makes contact with the electrode to provide less output. So if there is some problems in the transportation or concentration of the oxygen, then the reaction will not be possible, and if the reaction will not be possible, then there is no chance to produce electricity. So the overall voltage is basically the voltage which is produced by the fuel cell minus the losses. That is, number one is activation loss, the second one is ohmic loss, and the third one is transportation loss. So these are the ones. Now, the most important thing, which is basically the IV, which is current voltage, and PV graph of the fuel cell. So this is basically the IV graph of the fuel cell. If you see that this is dependent on the value of the current and the voltage, this is along the x-axis, this is the current, and then along y-axis is the voltage. So this is basically the IV curve of the fuel cell. Based on the IV curve, when we multiply the current with the voltage, it will produce a PV curve, and the PV curve is like this one. If you see, this is basically a hill shaped curve. If you see, then you will understand that there is some point where we can get maximum power. Other than that point, the power of the voltage and the current will be reduced. So the detail of this losses or this IV and PV curve is shown in this slide. And then if we need to find the appropriate area of the fuel cell or the current and the voltage value, then this is the approximation or the value, basic formula which is used to measure the area or the current required for the fuel cell. So the voltage is equal to 0.85 into minus 0.25 divided by area into I. So there is an example. A 1 kilowatt fuel cell operating on a continuous basis would provide all of the electrical need of the typical house. If such a fuel cell stack generate 48 volt DC with cell operating at 0.6 volt each, how many cells would be needed and what would be the membrane area? So we need to find out number of cells which are required, and secondly we need to find out the size of the fuel cell. So initially the output of the single cell is 0.6 and number of cells which is required is 48. So if we divide 48 divided by 0.6, it will give 80. So we required 80 cells. The second thing is that we need to find the current. So the current is basically the power divided by voltage, and power is 1000 watt divided by 80 cells divided by 0.6. So overall current would be 20.83%. So this is the current which we need. And if we put this current value in this equation, we will find the area of the fuel cell. So this is 0.6, which is basically the voltage, is equal to 0.85 minus 0.25 over A, where we put this value on this formula, and we put the current A over I over here, and when we calculate this, we find the area. So the area of the fuel cell would be 20.83 centimeter square. Now the most important thing is that how we can produce hydrogen. So the hydrogen, the best and easiest way to produce hydrogen will be the electrolysis process. And in electrolysis, we take 2 H2O and then we transfer some current, electrical current, into the water, and based on that current, the molecules of the hydrogen and the oxygen separated, and it produces hydrogen gas and the oxygen. This hydrogen gas will be stored in some cylinder to use for the fuel. So this is the chemical reaction. Normally photovoltaic and the wind turbines are installed at the remote area. We use the voltage of the photovoltaic and the wind turbine and the current of the wind turbine in the water tank to perform electrolysis process, and based on the electrolysis process, the bonding of H2O will be separated and hydrogen and oxygen will be released. The oxygen directly move to the environment, and while the hydrogen will be fed to the fuel cell in the form of cylinder, and then this fuel cell produces electric power. Thank you, Jazakallah. Hopefully you understand the basic concept or the characteristics of the fuel cell in hopefully if you have some problems or issues, you can contact me in the comment section. Thank you, Jazakallah. Stay blessed. Allah Hafiz.